Ark Royal is 21,000 tons of floating runway. And though by this deployment she's 25 years old, it's only 3 years since her last major refit. So as she sails off to head up a big task force called Auriga, it seems inconceivable that in a few months' time, she'll be steaming to retirement. But there'll be many surprises on the way. This will prove an eventful mission. First, though, she needs planes. Just as Noah's Ark was built to carry animals, Ark Royal's an empty vessel, unless she's bustling with aircraft. And now she's 16 kilometers out to sea, they start swarming in. Starting with three types of helicopter. The Lynx. It can reach speeds of over 300 kilometers an hour, making it one of the fastest helicopters in the world. Equipped with up to four lightweight sea skewer missiles that proved themselves in the Falklands in the first Gulf War, or it can carry Stingray anti-submarine torpedoes. Then, the Sea King Mark VII, airborne surveillance and control. It allows the ship to see over the horizon with its early warning search water radar, located in the dome on the side. The dome rotates through 90 degrees to allow the Sea King to land. And the Merlin. Designed to operate day and night in all weathers, it's a sophisticated new helicopter with a composite fuselage and three computer-controlled engines capable of more than 300 kilometers an hour. At 14 tons, it can carry a range of weapons including Stingray homing torpedoes or depth charges. Next to arrive, the Harriers of the Naval Strike Wing. In the Strategic Defense and Security Review last year, Britain's entire carrier strike capability was decommissioned. So this is the last time the full squadron will use Ark Royal's flight deck. As the jets are embarking, it's the job of Flight Lieutenant Chris Pearson, better known as Knick Knack, to guide them onto the Ark, two by two.
Okay, Roger.
Set sail this morning. We're about 10 miles south of the Isle of Wight, and what the idea is to get the jets on as quickly as we can so the engineers have a chance to do all their bits and pieces, and then we'll be ready to fly tomorrow. We're just about to recover the next two aeroplanes. The holding pattern above the ship and the ship are all going into wind, and then the jets will fly over the ship with 3 minutes to go to their landing time, and we call that the slot. So they'll slot 3 minutes before, and their landing time we call Charlie time, so they'll slot at minute 42 to land at minute 45. You can just make them out of the window, they're just going downwind now. There are four spots along the flight deck that you can land jets on, two, three, four, and six. And we're gonna land them on three and four spot.
The Harrier was the world's first fixed-wing strike aircraft capable of vertical takeoff and landing. As the jump jet pulls alongside Ark Royal, it's running at full throttle, producing 22,000 pounds of thrust, enough to lift 10 cars off the ground. Almost its entire engine thrust is diverted downwards through its four main nozzles. In forward flight, the jet's ailerons, rudder, and elevators are used to steer. But when the plane stops and hovers, there's no airflow. So instead, some of the engine's thrust is diverted to mini jet nozzles in the wingtips, tail, and nose. By opening and closing these mini jets, the Harrier's flown rather like a spacecraft. Ark's meeting the rest of her task group. Navies from Europe and the States will come together for an exercise called Joint Warrior. It's a test of her crew's ability to fight and defend the ship when she comes under attack.
Joint Warrior is an exercise that the Navy has run for over 50 years off northwest Scotland. It's a bit of a snowball effect. The more navies we can get, the more complex you can make the exercise and the more attractive it is to other navies. And that enables a really quite complicated exercise to be planned, which is really good for our training.
Starboard 20,
20 of starboard wheel on.
Steer 114.
Steer 114.
Down in the operations room, they're gearing up for the first joint warrior challenge.
To the northern disputed zone towards Norway. And we must be in a position to project parachute and protect ourselves. Hands to action stations, hands to action stations. Assume CBR and DC state one, condition Zulu.
The ship's preparing for war. And Warrant Officer John Walker, also known as Whiskey Walker, is in charge of damage control.
Well, the ship is now at state one, condition Zulu. That's our highest state of readiness. Effectively, HMS Ark Royal is ready to go to war. My job now is to go around quality control, all the checks, just to get people in the mindset of being at state one. OK, got your manning list?
Yep, got the manning list. Yeah. We've checked that all off and we're just about to send our guys out to start closing down.
OK, is everybody on board has got an action station? And we're going to close up now and just check that our manpower is in the right place, yeah, at the right time, and they all know what they're doing, what their jobs are. So, fellas,
right?
You happy with your manpower?
Yeah, happy with manpower. We had one person that was the wrong FRPP, but we got them back now, so that's fine.
Right. OK, what we're going to do now is a couple of drills. And the first one we'll do is the brace drill. And that's the position that we'll adopt if we detect a missile or an aircraft inbound. OK, FRPP, listen in. On anti-flash! Brace! Brace! Brace!
Whiskey knows firsthand why these drills are so important.
Yeah, I've done this a couple of times for real. First Gulf War, we detected a missile inbound. Brace! 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 When that call comes through, all sorts of things go through your mind. Family at home, your wife, your friends, there's all sorts of things. Fortunately, that was a false alarm, but they did pipe it over the main broadcast, so it was quite frightening. What are you doing with an iPod? Action stations, come and see me afterwards. Everybody stand up on anti-flash. Brace, brace, brace. Remain in the brace position until you hear the pipe. Stand to. Years ago, we used to lie on the deck. When a couple of ships got hit down the Falklands, it killed people because they got lifted off the deck and then slammed back down. So we bend your legs and your legs act as suspension. That helps you ride out the shock of a missile hitting the ship. Stand to! Stand to! Relax, anti-flash. Right, who was it who had the iPod? Right, report to me in HQ1 when we fall out from action stations. We'll have a discussion. They can't hear pipes over the main broadcast if they listen to music on an iPod. Right, but you'll find a lot of young lads, what they'll do is they'll wear an iPod underneath their anti-flash and think they'll get away with it. But we just obviously caught that young lad red-handed. I will deal with him later. I don't think he'll bring an iPod to his action station ever again. Action stations on HMS Ark Royal. Doesn't get any better.
With Ark now leading the Auriga task group, she starts her journey to the United States and Canada. The Harriers aboard Ark need practice. They land vertically, but to save fuel, they take off from the ski jump. And neither procedure is easy when the runway is traveling at 30 knots. Flight Lieutenant Chris Pearson has been a Harrier pilot for 5 years.
We're going to get airborne during the daytime, and then we'll aim to land on the ship at about 25 minutes after sunset, so it'll be a sort of what we call light duskers, so it'll be nearly dark, but not quite. So it's the first kind of step to doing it in darkness, really. I've never landed on an aircraft carrier at night. This is for us to see all the night lighting, see the references, practice the approach, and then slowly work towards doing it in full darkness.